Welcome to everybody. Nice to be here. And yeah, I like to be here. So it's the first time for me as a speaker. So I attended already a couple of years. But yeah, now I want to share my research topics that I have found. And I hope to entertain you a little bit.
Die, dickweeds.
A rabbit is in the administration system.
Send a flu shot.
Rabbit, flu shot, someone talk to me.
A rabbit replicates till it overloads a file, then it spreads like cancer.
Cancer? It's the Gibson, it's finding us too fast.
I think we should look the complete movie, so it's so funny.
Man, there's too many garbage files. I need more time.
Okay, that we can shift. So, hack the planet. So, 1996 already, they mentioned about hacking ships and vessels and by manipulating the balance of the ships. And that was movie stuff. Now we're coming to the real stuff. And maybe we see something else like this. We will see. The short agenda, a little bit about yachts, marina, one by one, so that you have a little bit background about how the stuff on board is working and what kind of systems they have and how they interact. So if you understand that, then you have a better idea about what's possible or not. Then we look at different attack vectors, then how to look up our targets. Then I show you some bugs in maritime internet routers that I have found, and also in one SATCOM device, and yeah, a small conclusion about that. Yeah, as already mentioned, I'm Stefan Gerling. You can also find me on Twitter as Obi-Wan666. So yeah, I'm older than the internet, certified with some certifications, and I'm an electronic specialist. Was a couple of years in the army. There I was working for navigation systems for helicopters, so it was very helpful, these background knowledge for my research in that time, that case here. And yeah, I'm a firefighter since 31 years, a volunteer firefighter in my town. And I'm working in the Rosen Group as an, yeah, let's say, security evangelist. So taking care about all types of security. And I'm helping also in our new branch, Certivation. So it's a spin-off of our company there. Of course, I avoid warranties and belonging to a group called Geraffel, and I'm the cavalry also. So we share our information in those kind of groups. Yeah, what could happen? So these are a couple of newspapers where there are business insiders about hacking, how hackers are targeting shipping industry, and a hacker carpet a yacht with his laptop, and cybercrime on high sea. And yeah, the newspaper getting more and more full with that stuff. So yeah, that was an also the thing, okay, the more and more people are looking on that, so why not me too? So when we look now for some accidents that I have figured out last year, there was in February, there was a container vessel that has 10 hours no navigational access to the systems. So they have to reboot their navigation system, and after that, they had access to it. So it was happening in the, how it is in South Africa area. So they mentioned that it could be some pirates that they have manipulated the navigation system, but they're not sure about that. And GPS jamming is also a very common story. So at 18 September in the Norwegian Sea, there was also a massive GPS jamming occurring. And it was in that time when the Russian people did some maneuvers in that area, and the Norwegian aircraft reported that there was some disturbing in the GPS signals. So, and then they go up with a helicopter with a special directed antenna, and they looked up the direction from where this comes. And then they figured out, okay, from Norwegian, it comes from the eastern side, so Russia, Ukraine, or in that area. So they're not really clear from which area, but it was from them from the eastern area. And the U.S. Navy had some accidents last year. So four warships of them had a collision with other ships. So now you think, okay, U.S. Marine, they should be trained well and very good in navigation, but they had four accidents with their warships, with a couple of casualties. For example, the USS Fitzgerald, they lost seven soldiers on board, seven Marines. So, they figured out that the container vessel was driving on the autopilot. They crashed into the warship. Because of the crash, the course get a new direction, and after half an hour, they make a U-turn and go back to the warship because they had an accident. So it take them half an hour to come back to the scene. And investigation from the U.S., they said then, okay, it was a human error because of they followed not the guidelines with normal navigation. But the first arguing about that was, is there something like cyber attacks on ships possible? The rumors comes up, but in the news they declined everything like that. So, and that's how we start now. Yeah, vessels, yachts, and ships. A yacht is a recreational boat. Comes from the German, from a Dutch word, yacht, and in Dutch it means something like hunting. And they use these small ships to hunt for the pirates in their lower countries of the Dutch countries. And, of course, size matters. A small boat is up to 7 meters. When we're talking about a yacht, we have already 10 meters. When we see a super yacht, it's about 24 meters or bigger. And then we have the mega yachts. They have 50 or 150 or more meters. So they're really, really, really big. So I don't know, from the German trash TV series, the Geissens, they have a ship called Indigo Star. It's a super yacht, 38 meters, and it's 7.7 meters wide. And so I looked up what kind of stuff is on those boards. You see already here some satellite dishes, some antennas, and so on, but we will see further. This is only a small listing about what is everything on those ships. So we have vessel traffic services, we have automatic information system, we have an autopilot, we have GPS, we have radar, we have cameras, we have thermal images cameras for navigating in the fog. We have engine control and monitoring systems. You can say it's an IoT or a PLC thing. We have internet access and we have entertainment systems. And all these systems are connected over some different buses together. One of these buses is the NMEA bus. So it's the National Marine Electronic Association that defined a bus system for the control system of those ships. So in the standard 0183, it's a serial bus protocol, not really fast, and they have some devices connected to that, for example, echo sounders, sonars, anemometers, gyrocompass, autopilots, and GPS receivers, and some others, temperature sensors, and so on. But with more and more technique on board, they need a faster bus, and the serial bus was not fast enough. So the new bus system was the NMEA 2000. And this one is already capable of a transmission speed of 1 megabit. And it's electrically like a canvas. So we have, like in the car industry, a canvas. We have in the ships now also a canvas. And yeah, most of you maybe know that if you have a canvas, you can play with the canvas as you want, if you have access to that. So how you can get access to that, we will maybe see. Yeah, the NMEA 2000 network is not electrically compatible with the NMEA 1083 bus, but there are converters for that. They're doing that stuff. And there are also faster networks, but we will see later. So this is how an NMEA bus looks like. So it's a complete bus here through the whole complete ship length. And all the systems are connected with T-connectors to those things. Here we have such a T-connector. And in really, they're looking like this. So it's a little bit weird. Looks like CheaperNet in the older days of the internet or the network cabling, but yeah. It's like that. The next generation, it's also in the marine industry. So we have here next generation Seatalk. Seatalk is only the name of the vendor Raymarine. So it's NMEA, but it's the next generation. It's a faster network of them. And these are only a selection of systems that they have here. This one we'll look up a little bit later on. Then we have also a Seatalk high speed. This is Ethernet. We have Ethernet on board with canvas speed. And also here we have a couple of systems that are working here, tablets, multimedia, cameras, and so on. Yeah, when you draw now a network map about those ships, then we have something like this. Starting here on the bottom, this is the NMEA network, and here we have the engine, the GPS, AIS, radar, sonar, autopilot, all those devices connected to the NMEA network. And from this network to the TCP/IP network, there are gateways. So there is a TCP/IP to NMEA gateway, and there is a USB gateway that's connected to a laptop or whatever. So those devices can be in a boat, or a ship, or a yacht, but must not. But if they are, then we have these normal network that we know, and then here are a couple of computers, tablets, Wi-Fi, and then we have internet access with a router, and it's connected then via SATCOM, Wi-Fi, or GSM. Yeah, now we're digging a little bit deeper. So a couple of systems that we have is the vessel transport services, or the vessel traffic services, the AIS, the ECDIS, the electronic chart display and information system, autopilot and internet access. So these are nice services. The vessel traffic services is it's like air traffic control in the aircraft in, or when you're flying. So there is a controller more or less in the harbor that has access to these vessel traffic services, and then selecting, okay, those ships are going in the harbor now, a container vessel or a yacht or whatever, and then they are saying, okay, you have to take this course, then you don't collide with those ships, and then so everything is fine. It's using radar, it's using also CCTV, VHF communication, and they're using the AIS information systems. So the AIS information system gives positioning information back to the vessel traffic services. The AIS service is an automatic tracking system. So there are also websites that you can use. So for example, marinetraffic.com is a favorite one, like Flight Radar 24. There you can see movements of ships that have these AIS system on board. So they're sending every a couple of seconds the position and the course and the speed and some other informations. The course and the positioning information they get from the GPS system. So the GPS system is sending the information of the positioning to the AIS system, and the AIS system is sending it back to the VTS system. So all depends on one GPS system later. And all is connected over the NMEA network. it's a little bit confusing, but it comes a little clearer. So the AIS system is also supplementing the radar system and also giving information for the ACTIS, for the chart plotter where we have these electronic navigation system, let's say. As in your car, you have a map of the waterways and where you can drive with your ship. And then in this chart display, then the positioning of your ship is displayed and also of the other ships with the AIS information that you get. So here you can see then in this ACTIS system what is going on. And this ACTIS system is getting the information from the AIS. And we remember AIS is getting it from a GPS. So it comes everything close together. And then we have the IT equipment on board. So we have internet access, we have GSM, we have Wi-Fi, we have some kind of SATCOM boxes. And on board we have entertainment systems and Wi-Fi for the guest, for the crew, for the owner, and for maintenance, for example, and so on. And on some boats we have also voice over IP systems. So, okay. When we look now in a server rack on a ship, so it's a complete fully equipped rack on an, let's say, on a super yacht. So here we have the router. That small device is giving the internet access. There's a GSM module in, there's Wi-Fi, and also connecting to the SATCOM boxes. Then we have here a set of three servers. Then there is two voice over IP boxes. They controlling the voice over IP network. Then we have here a switch and an UPS. And when we then collecting every information together, so we have 10 smart TVs and SAT receivers on board. We have one chart PC. We have 14 voice over IP telephones. We have an internet router, rack mounted switch, fully equipped, and four Wi-Fi access ports. So it's an IT department that's swimming on the sea. Who takes care about that? Mostly the captain. Does he really? We will not know. Some, yes, but the most people don't take care about that. Maybe in the maintenance phase, then they installing some patches and updates, but yeah, it's not really common. So yeah, we can say about smart ships, because more and more of these entertainment systems in these super yachts are connected with everything else. So you have here entertainment system that you can control via your iPad. You have these are pictures from iPads. This is the light scene control, so you can switch on and switch off all the lights on the ship. You have here this was a curtain control, so you can lower or raise the curtains. Here you have for the lighting scenes and different colors that you can give there, so that you have different color scenes. And you can also access via a tablet engine parameters like RPM, rudder, and the oil temperature, and also how many fuel is in your tanks and so on. So everything you can access with a tablet on board over Wi-Fi, and we will see later also over the internet, cloud-based. So then we have different attack vectors. So we can access the attack the internet routers that we will see later. We can attack the computers itself by sending some phishing mails and infecting the system with a malware, and then have remote access to that system. We can also try to infect the tablets or mobile phones. When we have attacked those systems, then we can try to search for those gateways that have access to the NMEA network, if it is not having already over the cloud services. And when we have that access, or we can directly access the system, then we have access to the NMEA network and can play with that. Yeah, as already mentioned, We can attack the systems over GPS, AIS, autopilot, IT equipment on board, the internet connection, cloud-based services, and so on. GPS spoofing or GPS attacks. So one thing is jamming the GPS signal, then you have no GPS signal, and then, okay, you have no current position, but most of the sailors or captains should be able to navigate manually. The US Navy, for example, has started again in, I think, 2011 to navigate again with sextants. So they have not trained it from, let's say, 2000 up to 2011, something like that. So they stopped with that because it was not mandatory. We have GPS, so we don't need that. But after they becoming more and more aware about GPS attacking, they started again to navigate with sextant and train that in the school. By the way, the German Marine didn't train that, so they trained it all the day. And they trained the first US Marines again with these techniques. Okay. So we have many of these GPS systems. So Global Navigation Satellite Systems is a name for that, so GNSS. And most of you knows the Navstar, that's a United States version. The Russian have their own one, it's called GLONASS. In European Union, we try to build up our own Galileo system, and the Chinese have their own navigation system called Baidu. All these systems working only on three different frequencies or basebands. So we have the L1 band, L2 band, L5 band, and the frequencies are close together. So that's very easy to just jam one of those signals, and then the GPS system is not working for that. Yeah, two scenarios are possible. So jamming and spoofing. While spoofing is a little bit harder, so you need special equipment, it costs a little bit more, and to make an accurate spoofing of GPS signals, you have to do a little bit more work. It's not impossible, but you have to be very close to the ships to fake those signals, that it is really accepted as a fake signal. So jamming is very easy for that. So spoofing, as I already said, it's not that easy because you need normally at least three valid signals of a satellite system. And from that three signals, then it's calculating the current position. So yeah, it's a little bit hard, but it's easier to fake the ANEMIA data that's then sent on the ANEMIA backplane. So the GPS sender is receiving the GPS positioning and sending the GPS positioning over the CAN bus. So think about that. But what we can do? That already mentioned that in June last week, there were more than 20 reports about GPS jamming in the Northeast Black Sea. It was the same time when NATO troops had a maneuver in that area, and that was then GPS anomalies in that time. And as already said, these Norway anomalies, you can also find the report here on this. There is also a protection system available. So the Deutsche Luftfahrt- und Raumfahrtzentrum, the DLR, is testing the Galant system. And the Galant system is a very nice thing. They have an 2x2 active antenna area. And this is how the pattern then looks like. And then from the pattern, then they can see by the incoming signals, then they can calculate, okay, it's an valid signal or it's an invalid signal, and filter out the invalid ones and boost up the valid ones. So it's a really nice research about that, and it's still under testing, but they had already really good result with that. So it could be that it is in the future an implementation that aircrafts or ships have. Yeah, the AIS system. So here you have a big overview about what everything of information is sent over those things. So every 2 to 10 seconds, the AIS transponder is sending a signal. So it says the maritime mobile service identification number. It's like the IMSI on your mobile phone. It says the status of the boat, like I'm on anchor, I'm on the engine, or I have an engine failure or something like that. It also gives the heading and the speed of the ships and some other informations. This is the information that you can see when you look up the marinetraffic.com website. Here you have the EMO, the MMSE, the call sign, under which flag is it a pleasure craft, and the year of the build. So by the way, this is from the Geissen yacht again. And here you can see it's moored anywhere in the harbor. And you have the position of it. So you can look up also on the on Google Maps for that, and then you find it. And it gives also some other information about it. So I speed up this part a little bit more. So afterwards, you can look up in the slides again. Every six minutes, you have also a bunch of other information. So the AIS system is very speakable. So it's calling everything. But it's very easy also. It's just a normal marina band channel in the channel 87 and 88. So it's under 161 megahertz and 162 megahertz. And with that, you can look up for the information that I sent. There is also a satellite-based system, but the cheapest one is these normal VHF radio one. So the modulation is GSM-NK, and it's 9,600 bits. And if you have an HEC-RF or some other SDR, just go to this website, download the GNU chart, and then you can look up your own informations. When you play a little bit with these chart, then you can also send faked informations. But that's illegal, I think. Don't do that. So as I already said, the ships sometimes have also autopilots. Yachts, for yachts, not so often, but sailing ships more. So when you're staying on deck and sailing, then you have a small handheld device. It's a little bit bigger than this. This is only a sample picture about that. And with that device, you can say, okay, this is the new heading and this is the new speed. So this is an example only from Raymarine. There's a controller for that. And yeah, when you look now with FCC ID search, because it's in Wi-Fi, it claims it'd be wireless. It's sending on the Wi-Fi 2.4 gigahertz. Then with the FCC ID search, you can see, okay, this is the frequency. It is wireless. It's not Wi-Fi. It's something else. In the documentation of FCC ID, you will find then, okay, we have an Admega 64 microprocessor in that. And it's an Ember transceiver EM2420. And it has an old stack protocol, Ember stack. So this is how it looks like. And yeah, at that point, I'm not further now. I'm still under investigation how the signal's looking, but yeah, lack of having a yacht every time in my pocket. So I have always to wait if someone is in place who has one of those autopilot systems, then I can record signals and play with that. So I'm still researching that topic. Yacht router hacking. Now we're coming to the nicer parts. One vendor that I have looked up was from Loco Marine. Loco is a Spanish word for mad. So maybe it's also their security model, it's mad. I don't know, but okay, Locomarine is the vendor. It's one of those boxes, it has three antennas, two for GSM, one for Wi-Fi, and this is a Wi-Fi booster. The Wi-Fi booster has 1.6 watt electrical transmission power, and with the right antenna, in this kind, it's a 7 dB antenna, we have 15 watt ERP sending power. So it's quite much. It's not allowed in normal areas, but on high seas, no problem. By the way, all the stuff is standard MikroTik equipment. So you can buy that on this one, you can buy on the website, and this one is only a new case over it. As already said, it's an Wi-Fi booster. It claims up to 15 nautical miles Wi-Fi access and 4G, 3G, or 2G up to 30 nautical miles. So that's quite far. Then you have a software for that. So this is a screenshot of the tablet. When you look up those systems then, you can see, okay, navigation, owner, captain, crew, VIP, blah, blah, and so on. And you can connect all those systems with each other and have different internet access areas. But the software has also some issues. The first one is when you start the tablet software, it making an FTP connect to the router. When it makes an FTP connect, it downloads an XML file. Guess what's in the XML file? All the changes that you can see on all the configuration information are in this XML file. And all, when you change something in the application, it sends back the XML file to the router. And it's FTP. It's clear text. They're using hard-coded credential in the software. And when you have access to the Wi-Fi, you can see it. But how to get access to that? It's also not that problem. That's only a shortcut about... So the username is Loco and the password is, don't laugh, secure connecting user. I said don't laugh. Okay, So it's a MikroTik router in this version, and then you can look up for that and so on and blah, blah. After I have seen that, I looked up, okay, the application, I have to look for that. So I looked up the application, downloaded the Windows version of that. It was an .NET application, so put it in ILSpy, and then you can look to all the nice informations, and they have some juicy information in that. Some names, here, Jerry, John, Franjo, Jerry Zof, and whatever. And in the J-Router engine, it's called. So YR, it's J-Router engine. And here you have the configuration, username, loco, password, the FTP address, and so on, blah, blah, and the Wi-Fi information and the default passwords that they have. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 is not a password. Okay. Next thing is, now you can think they have a firewall configured, but just make an nmap scan from the internet and then you find the FTP port is open, the SSH port is open, DNS, okay, and an interesting one is the 8291. So it says unknown, but we will see later. And the last point is they have remote support. You click on a button like remote support and it's connected. The only thing that you have to say is the contact details, name, email, phone number, the router model and the serial number. No IP address. How they will know that you are connected and which kind of IP address you have. Okay. Every time when you click on this remote access, remote help, then it makes a ping to their web server, and then they know the IP address of your model, of your system. Okay. What else we can do with that? As we had seen in the port scan, oops, that was too fast. The port is open, and it belongs to the Winbox management software. So for the MikroTik router, you have a Winbox management software that you can use, and it's connecting to that TCP/IP port. And with that, you have so many configuring options that you don't have in an application that they have built with that. So we have here access to the wireless, bridge, PPP, queues, terminal. A terminal. Terminal is really nice. So you have a connection with this software, and you can have terminal access now to the SHIP network and play with that. Think about that. And we have other one here, the hard-coded credential loco. It's a full user, and there is one Yere. So Yere we had seen in the source code. It's one of the developer of that. Okay, when we don't know the password, we can using tools like mkbrutos. It's a project that you can find on GitHub. It's quite common for MikroTik routers. Yeah. So now we have to find JOTS and what we can do with that. So when you go on the website, you see, okay, they have a JOT router on the board of Cantina. It's a really big one. Now we can look up marinetraffic.com, see for the marina and search for it, and then, okay, now we know it is on that position. It's in Split in Croatia, and yeah, the position, blah, blah, and so on. And the call sign for that, it's a pleasure craft. It's a quite new one, 2015, 3 years old. Okay. Then you can look up is now with Shodan. By the way, Shodan has now an own search engine for ships. I will show you later. Yeah, so I looked up for the MikroTik stuff in Shodan, and you can find them, some of them, and so on. You can also see, okay, here I have one on the Thames in London, and yeah, okay. I claimed this bug to the vendor. They said, okay, yeah, it's okay. Yeah, we fixed it. In November last year, they had to bring out a patch for that, and I got a permission from them. The permission was really nice, so I asked them, okay, when you have fixed it, I am able to present that. So they said, well, we cannot protect that. If you want to present it, you can present it, so feel free. Okay. So I also reserved a CVE for that, and so they still not committed it, but it's requested. A couple of weeks later, then they had a new version of that, and they sent it to me, and then asking me, can you test it again? So, and then I said, yeah, I have no test equipment. My test equipment is anywhere on the seas, so please send me something. So they sent me test equipment. I have it in my office now, and yeah. What they did was they had obfuscated the .NET application and using SSH instead of FTP. Okay, but security by obscurity is not really a solution. I tried to disassemble this with ILSpy again. I got some error decompiling, blah, blah, because they had somehow any protection measurements in it. Yeah, but what I forget was if you obfuscate something, obfuscate everything. So the Android application, they forgot. So the Android application was also a .NET application, and in the Android application you have the username loco and the password. This is the new one and still valid. And here's the old one. So when you look for that, it works. It's a little bit highlighted now, so you can easily see it. Then I found in the source code also some other stuff. So they had a class called Patch Backbone Data Leak. I don't know what does it mean. This is the code for that. I'm not really good in coding, but yeah, maybe it's saying something to you. Yeah, when you patch something, okay, what they use SSH is already good, but obfuscating is not really a good security model for that. And forgetting the other versions is also, the iOS version, I did not test it yet. They have still hard-coded credentials, you cannot change it, and the Winbox management software is still able to connect from the internet. So when you search for them, you can have fun with that. SATCOM devices. These are the last things that I will now present. These are the very expensive big boxes on the ship. You have offshore internet access. It costs massive money. Patching, most of them don't. Many old versions are online. And there were already some reports about that. So this is stuff that already other ones have presented. The Sailor 900, Inmarsat Solutions, and these are quite common search words that you can use in Shodan, and then you find those boxes. And Shodan has a ship tracker now, live one, since November last year. So when you use the URL shiptrackershodan.io, then you can play with that. It's collecting information about a VZ connected device. So there are a couple of other satellite systems, but they're only collecting now the VZ ones. But when you're looking for SATCOM boxes, so I was using Shodan a little bit, I was searching for some stuff, for some infectable yachts that I can find, and then I found something like digital antenna systems. So, that sounds good. I have to look more for that. And then with these were digital antenna systems, I come then to the COPAM MXP web server. And the search string that I then used was micro digital web server. And then you get a result like this. It's directly showing the antenna symbol, and then you have access to those boxes. That I quickly want to show. Dun, 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 dun. So here we have already one. Let's see how it is working. Now come on. Here we go. Let's try. Ah, it's responding, very good. Okay, here we have one, we can see here below, it has the version number 171, and so on. It's showing in the web, just showing the web page where you can log in. The nice thing is, when you log into that, I have to... I show it on the web page. So when you have it here, maybe we can see it here. Not really. Here you see they have a JavaScript called user login Java. Blum, 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 blum. And the nice part is here the function. Go menu by button, blah, blah, user, and so on. And this is the interesting part. It says, if login name like dealer, then use the URI menu dealer gx.html. So, yeah. Dun, dun, dun. Back to the presentation. So we looked up for that. These are the extracted parts of that. So there are three different login screens that you can have. Everything is in this login screen. So when you then look to one of those systems, so this is one other IP address, then you have access here. Okay, DLAR, and you have a system status and so on, a very poor signal, and you have a couple of things that you can do. So this one boat, and this is another one. Here I have already the command line interface of that system. So you have a command line interface where you can interact with the configuration of the satellite system for the SATCOM box. So you can completely switch off, reconfigure the antenna, configuring the modem system that's behind it. You can reveal the username and password of the modem and the IP addresses of the internal ones and so on. Everything you can find here over the command line. So a DDoS of those systems is no problem because just reconfigure it with something unuseful and then they have no internet access on the high sea. Yeah. By the way, if you read the fucking manual, then you find the username and passwords. So I love that part. DLAR is CTL3, sysadmin is CTL2, and user is CTL1. Yeah. Then I was looking for the ZVE numbers. So maybe someone has already found it. And yeah, fuck, someone was faster than I. But he has only reported in the version 1.2.1 with that build. So I can confirm it in those versions, and we have seen in the 1.7.1 also, it's missing here. So I have four different versions of the systems that still vulnerable to the same system. And these are the other web pages that you can use to have fun with those systems without authentication. So you can configure some port configuration, the I/O ports of the system. You have fun with the command line interface. You can change the antenna configuration. You can down or upload files. You can change the firmware if you want, rename the ship name in the menu, and you can reboot it. So there is still some fun in that. What's next? Yeah. More and more testing has to be done in that. Some other people are already looking up for that stuff. Let's kind of say vessel hacking is just in the beginning, but the vendors of the yachts, they are already implementing more and more useful services like cloud access. So this is from the Mariton website, where you can have an overview. They're already saying, okay, this is our ship network, we have some cloud services, and we have those systems that can connect over the cloud to everything here. So we can be... I don't have to be some kind of hellseher. I'm missing the word now. But I think we will see in future some applications that are vulnerable on the cloud area and then revealing all those informations. So this is a bigger picture of those cloud services, and then you have access, for example, for the monitoring system of the engine, you can have access to the webcams on board, engine parameters, electrical settings, compass, navigational systems, and some other stuff. So I think the future will have some funny stuff with that in for us. Yeah, conclusion for that is the NMEA gateway need to be more research, so someone has to do some work also in that kind. SATCOM boxes is a mess. VTS, I think, is completely unexplored yet. The autopilot system also, so someone has to work also on that. Injecting NMEA messages in the bus system. There is currently a research project running by the Fraunhofer. And yeah, GPS protection systems we will see in future, I think. And for my conclusion, I can say maritime cybersecurity is a couple of years behind our normal security settings. Yeah, may the force be with you. You can find me on the Twitter, OB1666, or my email address, sjerling@rosen-group.com. And thank you for that. Wow, just in time.
Thank you very much. We still have a few questions. Hello.
One question, the Croatian guys, you have the router there. Please check if they actually update the router, which they won't. And there's a remote exploit for Winbox, which is used for the VPN filter malware. I'm 99.9% sure it's vulnerable.
I think so, yeah. I switch it sometimes on in my office and to look what's happening on. Sometimes I'm wondering when I'm switching on, a couple of minutes later it's rebooting somehow. So then there is already something happening.
Watchdog.
Could maybe. I don't know. So I'm looking for that.
I don't know much about yachts, but is it like in an automobile where the steering is actually transmitted via the CAN bus, or is it separate?
Depends on.
That would be bad, I guess.
Normally, they have their own PLC systems for that. I'm not really sure if they are giving the steering connections over the CAN bus as an information to the system. So that's parts that I have to look up for, or someone has to look up for that. But in commercial ships, they have to be separated completely from different systems. So there, it should be not directly connected, but somehow maybe there's something possible. So, yeah, not really sure, but I think in some configurations there is something possible like that.
Okay.
We need a test ship. Who has one? Yeah, next question.
Another question.
Think there was one.
There was a long debate in the aviation industry for broadcasting, you know, for the, what do you call the maritime navigation system to broadcast the plane GPS location of the planes, because obviously terrorists can use that information. So I'm wondering, because I'm not from this field, is it compulsory to actually, do you have to always broadcast your GPS location to the navigation system, that, or can you switch it off? Like, because, you know, you can do quite nice things with this data, that website.
The GPS information they get all the times,
yeah.
And bigger ships have the AIS transponder,
yeah.
And it has to be switched on.
Okay.
But to protecting from pirates,
yeah.
In some areas they switch it off, fake the information,
right.
That pirates have not access to the right location of the
right.
ship.
Right. Okay. And
so,
is that for GDPR and this kind of stuff? Can you not publish those your GPS location on that website? How do you prevent that? You know, how come? Because if you know, like there are few people with very rich people with few yachts, and you can easily find out where they're going, right? Once you take, so that's something we can do after that. Yeah,
it's like that.
Yeah, cool. Okay.
So, if a ship has an AIS system, it's transmitting the position of that ship. So, that's how it is configured.
Okay, is there another question? No one?
I don't think so.
Okay, thank you very much.